The AGM-114 Hellfire, short for Hellebore Fire and Forget, is the quintessential air-to-ground missile in the U.S. inventory, having seen continuous combat since the Persian Gulf War. Because of its outstanding operational successes and innovative technologies, the Hellfire is the weapon of choice for both conventional and unconventional strikes. However, with a price tag of about $100,000 per missile, some people might be shocked at how such a common weapon system is so expensive. So what really makes the Hellfire so special? The story of the Hellfire begins in the 1970s. The US and the Soviet Union were still in a heated arms race to build both bigger and more technologically advanced militaries than their adversary. The US planners knew that if the two powers ever got into a full-blown kinetic conflict, the US and its allies would be at a severe numerical disadvantage in terms of manpower and equipment. In the USSR, quantity mattered a lot more than quality, so although their weapon systems were much less capable than their NATO counterparts, they were built at a fraction of the cost and on a scale that dwarfed the US and NATO production capabilities. Because of the huge disparity in equipment, the US military sought to create a weapon system that could deal with waves upon waves of advancing Soviet armor in quick succession. After years of research and development, the US finally developed the Hellfire missile, entering service in the early 1980s. Since its inception, the missile has primarily been launched from a rotary wing aviation platform. For the Army, this is the Apache, while the Marine Corps uses them on Super Cobra and now Viper attack helicopters. Navy helicopters also employ them on the MH-60 Romeo and MH-60 Sierra helicopters. However, as technologies advanced, the US military has also started employing the weapon on other platforms. For fixed-wing aviation, the Air Force uses the Hellfire on its armed drones, including the MQ-1 Predator and MQ-9 Reaper drones. The Marine Corps has also equipped some of its KC-130J tankers, where it's referred to as the Harvest Hawk. Additionally, even the US Navy has experimented with placing Hellfire launchers on some of its ships. Testing's been carried out on the Independence-class littoral combat ships, though their future as a permanent weapon system is unknown. The missile came too late to see action in the Vietnam War, instead getting its baptism of fire in the 1989 invasion of Panama. While there were few Panamanian armored vehicles for the missile to destroy, the missile showed promising results. The first real test of its efficacy in combat came during the Persian Gulf War in 1991. During this conflict, over 3,700 of Iraq's nearly 4,300 tanks were destroyed. Of these, it's estimated around half were destroyed by combat aviation, with Hellfire missiles making up a large chunk of those confirmed kills. But beyond just tanks, the US military successfully annihilated thousands of armored personnel carriers, artillery positions, command and control centers, and air defense sites using it. Largely because of the huge operational success in the Gulf War, US military planners realized that the Hellfire was indispensable for modern warfare. As a result, production was quickly ramped up, and since its inception, over 100,000 Hellfire missiles of various types and variants have been made for both US stocks and for over 30 allied militaries worldwide. But how was the US able to employ the Hellfire so successfully, both during this conflict and in war zones across the Middle East over the past 30 years? The Hellfire has one big advantage over other missiles that makes it a much more effective and precise weapon. It can be controlled by an operator from launch to impact. Inside the original models of the Hellfire is a receiver that picks up on a specially coded laser designator signal. Because of this, the operator on the ground or in the air must paint the target with the laser. The Hellfire seeks the particular infrared wavelength of the designator and corrects its flight path to hit the painted target. Of course, there are a few disadvantages of this method. Firstly, forward observers must expose themselves to enemy fire to ensure the target remains lased until the moment of impact. Not doing so could result in the missile flying off target and missing it, or worse, causing harm to friendly units. The firing unit would also be exposed to enemy fire if the aircraft is the one lasing the target. However, operators can use a few firing modes to limit their exposure to retaliatory attacks, depending on the situation. The first of these firing modes is the lock-on before launch mode. In this mode, the forward observer lases the target and communicates with the firing unit. Once the firing unit confirms the missiles have a lock on the target, they can fire it and egress from the area. With this method, the pilots can guarantee a strike because the missile already has a bead on the target before it even leaves the rails. But there is a slight disadvantage. When using this method, the Hellfire is pre-programmed to adjust its height based on an equation between the distance from the firing unit to the target. The further away the firing unit is from the target, the higher the missile will fly. While this might not sound like a big deal, it could inadvertently help the enemy since the higher a missile flies before descending, the more time the enemy has to move from their location or shoot it down. The only way to decrease this altitude is by making the firing unit get closer to the target, exposing them to more counterfire. Because of this drawback, engineers designed the Hellfire to operate in one of several other modes to give units in the field tactical maneuvering space depending on the situation. For example, lock-on after launch is the other main way to fire a Hellfire. Using this method, the firing unit, such as an Apache, can fire the missile toward the target without having the forward observer laser the target first. During flight, the observer can then laser the target, and the missile will course correct onto it. While it might sound crazy to fire a missile before designating a target, it does have its advantages. Firstly, the missile will guide itself along its minimum altitude when fired like this. By doing this, it keeps the missile under the minimum effective depression of most enemy air defense radars. It'll also reach the target at its maximum effective range, around 8 kilometers, faster than using the high arc of the lock-on before launch method. However, the main drawback is still, of course, the possibility of the Hellfire never actually acquiring the target before impact, resulting in a miss or a friendly fire incident. Because of this drawback, the lock-on after launch method has two sub-modes to choose from. The first of these is lock-on after launch high. By choosing this firing mode, the operator can stay behind cover, like behind a mountain range, and fire the missile so that when it leaves the rails, it'll climb at least 1,000 feet above an obstruction, such as a ridge, a bridge, or a building. Once over the obstruction, the missile will seek out a laser designator and lock on to the target. But while this method provides the highest chance of survival for the firing unit, it too has its drawbacks. The main drawback is the fact that once the Hellfire comes off the rail, it can lose its lock on the target if its view is obstructed by lower-hanging clouds. We wouldn't recommend using this method on a cloudy day, as there's a high chance the missile could lose track of its target and fly off course. To compensate for this, the lock-on after launch low option is available. This sub-mode is essentially the same as lock-on after launch high, but instead of clearing a 1,000-foot obstruction, the Hellfire can only go over a 260-foot obstruction. However, the missile will not go higher than 600 feet, allowing it to fly under most low-hanging clouds and increasing its chance of maintaining its lock-on target. But even though the Hellfire is incredibly versatile, there are a few drawbacks to using a laser designator. This has led to the development of the Longbow Hellfire, which doesn't use the antiquated lasing target system. Lasing targets for the Hellfire is not as simple as pointing a laser beam at the enemy and watching freedom rain down on them from above. In fact, there's a ton of physics and science involved that makes something as simple as a giant laser pointer challenging to use on the battlefield. The first of these challenges is beam divergence. Generally speaking, the further away a target is from the observer, the greater the width of the beam will be. This results in the spot the Hellfire is seeking getting larger and larger the further away a target is from the operator. For example, if an operator is lasing an enemy tank near the maximum range of the Hellfire, the beam of divergence could be so great that rather than specifically lighting up the tank's side, the beam highlights the tank in general, leading to a lock on its tracks rather than the more vulnerable side armor. Though the tank would still be hit, this could result in just a mobility kill rather than a mission kill, meaning the tank could still continue firing at friendly forces. Another example of laser drawbacks come from a phenomenon called attenuation. This describes the overall strength of the beam that's reflected back to the Hellfire, using it for guidance. Beam divergence naturally increases attenuation, since the wider a beam is, the less energy gets reflected from a larger spot. However, weather conditions can make attenuation much, much worse. Heavy fog, dust, smoke, sand, and even rain will generate huge amounts of attenuation as the laser beam's energy is bounced off the particles in the air. As a result, using the Hellfire in adverse weather conditions severely impacts its effective range and accuracy. Attenuation can also affect the Hellfire's ability to lock on because of a condition known as backspatter. If heavy weather conditions are plaguing the battlefield, obscurants like sand, smoke, and fog can reflect greater amounts of energy than the target. As a result, the Hellfire could confuse a cloud or a particularly dense patch of dust in the air as the tank the operator was trying to destroy. The multiple woes don't stop there, as there are two more things that can affect its laser guidance system: overspill and underspill. These two conditions are usually seen at the extreme ends of Hellfire's range. At greater distances, the laser beam might spill some energy over the top of the target or could reflect off the ground in front of the target. This is because trying to lase a tiny target at extreme ranges can be extremely difficult under the best circumstances, much less under fire. As a result, the Hellfire could fly harmlessly over or fall short of the intended target. Because of these issues with laser guidance, the US military began working on a newer version of the Hellfire, one with a fire-and-forget ability that could be guided by its own onboard sensors. After years of research, the Longbow variant was developed and was the first Hellfire to be truly self-guiding. Using its own radar, the Hellfire can receive a track either from the firing unit or just a rough position of the enemy. Once in flight, the Longbow's radar seeker can send its energy beam to the target and then self-correct its course until eventually it delivers some explosive freedom with accuracy. And a sizable price tag, of course. Even though the Hellfire is incredibly versatile in how it can be fired, how exactly does it work? Let's look at the missile's journey from when it's fired to when it reaches its unfortunate target. Despite the variations between the different modes, Hellfire weighs in at between 97 and 108 pounds each. The missile itself is 5.3 feet long and has a diameter of 7 inches. It travels at around 950 miles per hour and is powered by solid-state rocket fuel. Despite the slight differences in weight between the models, each Hellfire has the same basic components. The propulsion section is the part of the missile that makes it move forward. It has enough fuel for about 2 to 3 seconds of burn time and generates up to 10 Gs of thrust in order to arm the missile once in flight. The seeker section is the part of the missile that receives the infrared signals sent from the laser designator or its own returns for longbows. Once the seeker section gets this data, it passes it along to the guidance section. The guidance section is the brains of the Hellfire, taking the data from the seeker section and sending commands to the control section. Once the control section receives a command, it uses a pneumatic actuation system to control a series of fins that move the missile up, down, left, and right, much like an airplane. As the Hellfire contacts the target, the impact sensor inside the warhead sends an electrical signal that sets off a fuse at the back of a shaped charge. Regardless of the variant, each Hellfire will have these basic components. However, over time, the US has made numerous improvements to the missiles, resulting in almost a dozen variants in the Hellfire family. Let's look at them and discuss what sets them all apart. The Alpha variant is the OG Hellfire. This was the basic model with all the previous features mentioned. In addition, it also had a low smoke motor that made it hard to detect visually. However, this variant has the highest overall trajectories out of all the variants, since the technology required for lower flying missiles wasn't available when it was first designed. The Bravo variant has improved low visibility capabilities over the Alpha variant. This means that in areas with poor environmental conditions, the missile's less likely to lose track of the target. The rocket motor on this variant was also upgraded to decrease the amount of smoke it emits. Bravo variants are also equipped with a safe and arm device that provide an electrical and mechanical safety so the weapon can be transported safely, allowing the Navy and Marine Corps to store them on ships. The Charlie variants have all the same features as the Bravo ones, except they do not have a safe and arm device. Of note, the Alphas, Bravos, and Charlies are all equipped with a single-shaped charge warhead. Each guidance system is also analog and non-programmable. The Foxtrot variants incorporate the same technology as the Charlies, with the only difference being that the Foxtrots have a tandem warhead. These warheads are often equipped with two explosive charges which detonate one after the other, most often used to defeat reactive armor, a type of add-on armor plating comprised of two sheets of metal with a high explosive charge sandwiched in the middle. These add-on plates were created to protect armored vehicles, most often tanks, from shaped charges by detonating them before they could penetrate the vehicle's armor. By having two charges, a tandem warhead can detonate the reactive armor of a vehicle while allowing the second charge to go through the armor. The Kilo versions were a great leap in Hellfire technology. These were the first missiles to be both programmable and have digital autopilot. The Kilos can also reacquire a target even after flying through poor weather conditions like clouds. If the missile loses track, it's programmed to point itself down to get closer to the ground and past any weather obstructions, allowing it to once again lock onto its target. Kilos also come standard with tandem warheads in addition to being hardened against electronic countermeasures meant to take them down. As mentioned previously, the Longbow is the first and only Hellfire to have its own onboard radar seeker. The missile sports analog and digital guidance control systems, making it more resistant to emerging electronic countermeasures. The Longbow comes standard with tandem warheads and has improved all-weather capabilities for maintaining track. The Mike versions have most of the same features of the Longbow, such as resistance to countermeasures and all-weather capability. However, they differ in two main areas. Firstly, it still relies on the tried-and-true semi-active laser designation method. Secondly, it's equipped with a high-fragmentation warhead. This new warhead was designed to be used against lightly armored opponents. Troops in the open, lightly armored vehicles, buildings, and small watercraft are all possible targets that a standard-shaped charge would not have as much effect against. November variants are one of the main types used by the Navy. This missile is similar to the Mike variants, except for the explosives. Here, the warhead has been replaced with a thermobaric warhead or a metal-augmented charge. Both the November and Mike variants have been designed to penetrate a structure or a ship first. Once inside, it detonates. The Papa variant is essentially a Kilo variant that's been modified for fixed-wing aircraft, primarily unmanned aerial systems. Romeo variants include all the capabilities of the previous Hellfires minus the millimeter wave radar, with one major difference. Romeos have a dual-purpose warhead that's powerful enough to penetrate tank armor while also having the ability to cause serious damage to soft targets. The so-called ninja missile, or knife bomb, the AGM-114 R9X, is perhaps the most exotic and controversial of the entire Hellfire family. Carried on some of America's most secret armed drones, the R9X has a unique warhead. Instead of an explosive charge, the missile deploys 6 18-inch blades that are released from its midsection just before impact. These blades have a kill radius of approximately 3 feet and have been used in many high-profile strikes, including a 2017 strike that killed the deputy leader of Al-Qaeda, a 2019 strike that killed the mastermind behind the Cole bombing, and a 2020 strike that killed another senior Al-Qaeda operative. Because of the secretive nature of these weapons, they are exclusively used by units under the Special Operation Command and the CIA for targeted attacks against high-profile individuals. Even though the US has a ton of different Hellfire missiles, this legendary system is still getting upgrades. For many in the US defense sphere, maintaining and upgrading the system is a no-brainer. The missile has proven itself invaluable on the battlefield, providing the US Armed Forces with a variety of tactical advantages over their wide range of enemies. The first of these advantages is its precision guidance. As mentioned previously, whether a laser is guiding the Hellfire or if a longbow is using its own radar, the Hellfire is a very precise weapon. Because it is so precise, the chances of it causing collateral damage in a crowded urban environment is minimal. Additionally, the risk of friendly fire is also low. US commanders love Hellfires because of how modular they are. Though there are many different types, each one has a basic design, and that means the Army, Navy, Marine Corps, and Air Force units working with each other can all use the same type of ammunition. This improves interoperability and cuts down on the supply chain issues often created by having to source different ordnance for different aircraft. In addition to its modularity, its anti-armor capability is unparalleled. There's arguably not a single air-to-ground missile that has destroyed more tanks and armored vehicles than the Hellfire has done in the past 30 years. The Hellfire is by far the most combat-proven system for heliborne aviation supporting ground forces. It's no wonder why dozens of militaries have adopted the technology. Another reason militaries worldwide choose the Hellfire is because of target verification required to launch the missile. Whether the operator is lasing the target or a pilot tells the longbow where to go, a human has to have positively identified this enemy. Unlike indirect fire systems like artillery or unguided aerial bombs, there's a human involved in the process from the time the missile leaves the rails until it eventually explodes, at least most of the time. Such a feature is very appealing to the militaries who must adhere to strict rules of engagement when fighting unconventional enemies while also following the laws of war and limiting civilian casualties. In addition to protecting innocent civilians from unnecessary damage, the Hellfire also protects firing units. With features such as exhaust cooling, no-smoke motors, and a minimal launch signature, the Hellfire is a great weapon that allows units to fire at the enemy with a low risk of return fire. On top of all this, the Hellfire is so special because of its proven track record. Whether fighting conventional conflicts against scores of armored vehicles or carrying out precision strikes to eliminate terrorist leaders, the Hellfire is a one-size-fits-all weapon. No matter the problem, the US and its allies have a weapon that can solve it. Because of that, the Hellfire will likely continue to serve for generations to come despite its huge cost due to how versatile and effective it's been on the battlefield. Now check out most insane weapons the US military is actually using today, or watch the 5 most dangerous pistols on the planet.